talk with, but I think, you know, feel free to interrupt me and ask for more levels of detail about what we did. I'm going to talk about a project at Dunkennell Hill Primary School, which was with Ben Barrett, who was mentioned earlier, borrowing the equipment that you saw in the picture earlier, the sort of square monitors for black carbon as a proxy for and GPS. And then I'll talk a bit about an NO2 tube monitoring project and then a future one that we're hoping to do. So this is Dunkennell Hill. It's a 1930s LCC estate, about 750 flats. And it's got a very wide road for inner London. It's a dual carriageway. There used to be a tramway up the centre, which is why it's so huge. And then at the top of the hill, there are traffic lights. It's one of the schools that TfL identified, Clean Air in London identified as being within 150 metres of roads carrying 10,000 or more vehicles per day. So the local authority monitoring, Southwark, showed 550 vehicles in one direction in 1 hour between 8 and 9, and that was in 2011. And then the 2015 count showed that that had actually doubled in some directions. But car ownership is very low, it's around 30%. So it's a classic case of people being exposed to high levels of pollution from vehicles passing through where car ownership is quite low. And there's the school at the top of the hill. So it's right at the junction where all the traffic stops, and there's a bus stop right outside. You can just see on the right-hand side of the picture. There are four buses that stop there, and they're real old-fashioned diesel belching buses. So I went into the schools, and in lots of ways they're sort of similar stages, but I'd really love to hear more about how you managed to work with sort of six weeks. We did an initial brainstorm in a year four class, so they were 8 to 9 year olds, about the causes of air pollution. This is the teacher's record of the causes. And she was very engaged and lively and really participated in it, so was already committed to working on air pollution. So I think that was a huge help in finding the right person in the school. And then we did a mapping of how people get to school, so had a large-scale map, and children put flags about where they lived. And most of them are fairly local, some have very short journeys indeed, but then others, you know, circumstances change and they end up having quite long journeys, in one case 45 minutes. And these were some drawings of the route to school. And what I found really intriguing was the level of detail that came with different modes of transport. So it wasn't quite as clear as to say that if you're driving, you don't see anything else, you're just in the car, because some of the children who were driven did notice landmarks, but there was a kind of overall difference in the richness of detail that children walking to school were much more likely to say, that's the lollipop lady, that's the shop. So I'd be really interested in thinking about more mapping where we could layer over kind of air pollution results, noise results, and the emotional affective feelings about different places.
Well, if I could just say a point there, my daughter, who's in year one at the moment, they are literally doing a geography introduction to geography about what do you see on your way to school.
Yeah.
So there is already sort of ins for linking to the curriculum that's already there. So
that's going with that. That's a question I'd like to talk more about how we kind of show the links to the curriculum. So this is a quite a long, interesting walk, and this has got the lollipop lady on it. So this is someone who's probably it's about a 20-minute walk. This is, again, quite a rich walk. A lot of detail, not very long one. This child has two possible ways, depending on traffic, but it's a 45-minute journey because the family moved. so really very bleak. I drive to school. I don't know what happened on the way. I drive to school.
Mm. Early driver.
Sorry?
I mean, it's early to drive.
Yeah, yeah. So, and then this is the visualization that came back from Kings of the monitors. So we had monitors with GPS so that they would show where the readings were being taken, and tried to pair up children who were taking different routes to the same destination. But in fact, that didn't work terribly well because often the children taking different routes to the same destination. Things happened. They had Spanish that afternoon, so the pair didn't work, or people who lived near wanted to walk together, which made sense rather than sending one on one route and one on the other. So what we ended up doing was having adult volunteers, one walking one route, normally the more polluted route, and then the child would take their normal route home. So this is all of the results, and then this is some more detailed comparison. So this is going on the left-hand side, the results going along the bus route down the main road with the shops. And
Helena, you probably need to point onto this so people can see. It's just I can see you pointing at the screen there.
Yeah, and it's also completely different colours. it is. Oh, well, that's not very helpful at all.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, that's really helpful. So this image really should have dark red dots showing how the colours are completely different on this display than they
are. The darker dots are higher concentration.
Yeah. So it was quite a strong suggestion a strong demonstration that going along the road, the main road, was twice as much exposure to particulates as to back roads, which was what the study was designed to find out. That's the same information on one map.
That's really quite a long distance, isn't it? What are we looking at? Are those 100 metre boxes or 200 metre on there?
The intervals were a minute. So it's a short walk.
Oh, okay, only a minute.
One of the things that came out, because of my study was a pilot with Ben Barrett, they were just starting the community-led citizen science projects, and they said, we should really have smaller intervals because we're looking at fairly short journeys. So actually a minute is not long enough to see the distance and see the pollution levels at each junction. This was another journey. Again, it's not terribly clear, but the one on the left again has twice the levels of exposure to particulates, and that's going along the main roads as opposed to going through a park. So that's all I'll say about the schools project for the moment, but I can talk more about what happened with it. Then we did some NO2 monitoring across the borough of Southwark, just using diffusion tubes for a month. And those levels, this is just a Google map that we put them on, and it was published in this Southwark News a couple of weeks ago. And we were definitely trying to locate the monitors by schools or places with sort of meaning for people. So in a way people have said, you'd expect Tooley Street by the London Dungeon to be high. It's London Bridge. But they didn't expect McDonald's in a sort of town centre, Camberwell, but it's a very busy bus exchange. So that's more than twice the legal limit of NO2. And then we've got four or five different schools.
Did you do any of the peak monitoring at the same time?
No. So it was just the...
Because if your average is 88, you might have not also achieved the 200.
Mm-hmm.
in a month, quite easily.
So what we'd like to do is to do some work with schools with sort of taking these results in, because the very simple measures about informing schools about high pollution days and about being aware, and perhaps it might be a question of teachers being aware of when pupils might need to use inhalers more or whatever, just very simple things about sharing information about high pollution days is just not happening. So we want to start more of a dialogue with schools. And this is a school that approached me, who are also doing a green screen project. So they're fundraising at the moment. And I'm talking to them about whether we might do some before and after monitoring so that they become a bit of a demonstration project for other schools, because they're not part of the initial mayor's audit, but there are 50 schools in our borough that could benefit from the second.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much all I wanted to say.
Great. We could, we can take the Q&A from here, really. If you want to come back into the circle, then that'd be great. If you want to use this flip chart and draw on it, Jenny, you wanted to say a bit about Jill's monitoring. Jill's not here because she has food poisoning, so Jenny's going to get a quick resume.
Say to people earlier that Jill was about, I don't know, she was 25 years in the same primary school in Charlton, near Charlton Football Ground, which is part of Greenwich Borough, and she was very concerned that the playground was on the road, and because she was involved with the Silvertown Tunnel project, they'd already been testing, and it's a shame she's not here, because they did work with King's College Professor Ian Mudway, because what nobody has said is the medical side of all of this, that children's lungs, if they're damaged early, they don't fully grow, and I think that's a very frightening statistic. And nobody seems to mention it, but I think that's a very good reason to monitor outside the schools. And Jill did it over quite 4 or 5 years, only, I don't know if it was a couple of times a month. And it was sort of in the 40s. Now, since then, some of those, road traffic has increased dramatically. There's a hill that the school is on, the side hill that feeds into a road. It's the main road between Woolwich, which is a big place, and Greenwich. So it's only single carriageway, and yet it's normally at a standstill. So especially like Fridays and people going out in the evening. And they've built a new shopping centre now on that road. So you've got quite a lot of extra shops on this bottom road. And what Jill's particularly concerned about is people living up the top will now have a rat run down the hill, past the school, round the corner into the Sainsbury's, the Marks, so this whole new shopping centre is literally round the corner from the school. Now, I don't... So this is the monitoring that started in 2013. So they have done one in 2017, which, as you can see, is above the limit. But in this area, they're talking about, and in fact, they bought the ground to have an IKEA. So hundreds of people, not only will they be coming to the new shopping centre, hundreds of people will be going to IKEA, and she's worried about it coming down the hill, or even the road at the bottom, because these children have got to go home, they've got to get to school, they've got to go home. And it's a single carriageway road, the main road. And then behind that, to the left, is going to be a massive IKEA. So
the problem with diffusion tubes, and especially when you're placing them on an annual average, which is what you've got here.
Just 1 month.
They're not representative.
No, but they,
because
see, there's June, January.
Yeah.
They did do some different ones, and they settled on the February.
Yeah.
Which is normally the highest of the year.
No, April is the highest.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Well, there's that you have.
Yeah.
That's a new one. But the other aspect of Jill's work, but it's Professor Ian Mudway's work,
yeah,
is with regarding the children's health.
Yeah.
And that I can't tell you about, but
there's
that was
nice
done with King's
San
College.
San Francisco study showing the atrophyism of the lungs, mm-hmm, by energy and the other particles. Are you doing just NO2 or are you doing particles?
Well, no, I only do NO2, but I don't know because Jill isn't here. Jill was the teacher.
Yeah.
And I imagine that she could give people the references to Professor Ian Mudway's work.
Yeah.
I don't know anything on that side.
That's brilliant, you've done so long.
But no, this is Jill with the lady who's not, unfortunately, not well today.
Okay.
They have, as I said about Nota Silver Town, which is trying to stop another tunnel coming through past all this already massive area of pollution. There are 9 schools in Eltham that they have been encouraged and sponsored by the group that Jill belongs to. So they've done their first monitoring. So Eltham is southeast London. It's just that bit further out than Woolwich and Greenwich. It's still Greenwich Borough, but it's the tip of Greenwich Borough. So it's spreading the monitoring out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people think, oh, it's only in central London, but it's going out and out and the wind blows. People don't understand. So I think if you test at your school, you need to partner up with someone in the next borough just to see how it's going in the next borough. Obviously,
yeah,
it's all a matter of funds.
We need directional indicators. I mean,
yeah,
we affect Norway, so you know, our emissions go to Norway.
Yeah.
Jenny, have you also accessed Greenwich Council's own monitoring results? Because they will have some as well.
Pass. You would have to ask Jill.
Mm.
Now, I'm in Bexley Borough, and as I said to you, worry about the wind blowing. And I myself haven't really, I'm here to learn how the schools are doing it.
Mm.
We've done it as a Slade Green Forum because we were concerned about the dual carriageway. Bexley Borough, as I said earlier on, have a monitoring site which is off the dual carriageway, a single carriageway, and round the corner. So it's a distance from the main road. So they're getting, say, 21, wonderful. Bexley is a moderate area, in brackets, which everybody might sit back and think, oh, it's only London, it's not us. But when you actually yourselves monitor, and you're getting 70s, and up to the highest we've had is 100, you know, Bexley is not altogether. And there's a school sideways on, just the edge of the playground onto the dual carriageway and a nursery. And what I'm interested in is trying to get these people involved. Although they've got trees, but some particulates must get over into the playground. So they're side on, both of them. But this routes to school, I think, is very important. People should understand this because so many people must be walking down the carriageway. And that's where I've really come from, with our group, which has been monitoring on the carriageway, but we need to take it into the schools and get the schools involved.
So we're going to go on until 1:15, so please feel free to ask Phil or Hassan any questions about the presentation that you might have about the projects.
I think at the end you would give everybody's email so people can email Jill direct, perhaps, is the best thing about the contact with King's College, what they've done and what she knows. I'm sure Jill will, on her Silvertown side.
Mm. I was just asking because, I mean, in Southwark, I know that the council has been doing diffusion tube monitoring. It's really hard to get those results into the public domain. They are, they're not published. They're supposed to be published, but if you ask for a copy, It's too large to put on the website. We're going to have to print it off and post it to you.
But did you get it?
I did get it in the end, but I think we can make more use of the existing results, but also point to the kind of gaps that you're talking about, where the monitor is in the wrong place, and where our own monitoring shows.
I think that's really interesting. So something London Sustainability Exchange have done various citizen science, NO2 monitoring, Mapping for Change at UCL have done some, lots of people have done some through various different organisations, and all of this data, and the local authorities, and then you've got King's, and King's is probably the only thing that is some kind of umbrella over London, yet you've got all of this incredible data. It's, and the whole idea, in my mind at the moment, the whole idea, we started from thinking, well, let's measure. The whole idea of measuring is almost, it's just to tell us what we already know. So I think the interesting thing for us that can come out of measuring is, I think it is kind of fundamentally sort of teaching people, particularly perhaps children, and getting their parents engaged, with them having that kind of engagement with measuring and seeing the results and playing with them and understanding them, and then disseminating that is really useful. So from that point of view, measuring is still beneficial. To some extent, I think we may be spending quite a lot of time and effort doing monitoring, when actually the data is already there, and would we not be better placed looking at how we can deal with the issue? That's not to say we're not dealing with the issue or trying to deal with the issue. But so I'm kind of that's just one thought. I thought your presentation. I thought the idea of the kids drawing a map for their route to school was brilliant. I think that is really clever, because I think that really, one, that engages them in their route to school stuff.